So yes, hello everyone, this is Abhinaya. I'm working here as a software engineer. So I'll be giving a brush up for you. You cannot learn a language in a day, but I will hope my level best to give my knowledge to you, like at least a bit. So how many of you are familiar with the object-oriented programming? Oh yeah, everyone, then it'll be easy for me, right? So C++ or like you learn Java?
Java.
Java, everybody learn Java. So yeah, then whoever has learned Java are going to explain me, like going to interact me and help your partners nearby. So Java is object-oriented programming language. Everybody knows it. So what are the features of Java? So people say it's platform independent. Why is it platform independent? So it compiles and gives us a class file which can be run in any environment. So we call it a platform independent language. And simple, do you think it's simple? Kind of simple. Let's see how it works. Secure. Do you mean to say C++ is not secure? You mean to say PHP is not secure? So somebody over here was speaking about SQL injections, right? We can easily prevent SQL injections in Java. So there is something called as you have some query here. Okay, select. There is a table. So there is a table called login. This is an example I'm giving for a secure thing. So if you are going to choose, like, for example, so there are like two entries. For example, I'm just giving you, for example, you have a login page. Okay, you have a login page. You're going to fetch the data. Like for example, the first one, I'm taking it from the interface. Enter the login name, enter the password. So if you select from the database, I select star from login where login name is equal to, if you are going to pass a function with these two variables as such, for example ABCD and password MD5 of whatever, you are going to have SQL injection if you pass the functions this way. So Java has something called as prepare statement dot set string of. So if you use prepare statement, prepare statement and set the strings over there. So you can stop SQL injections this way. If a system is not secure, if you use or equal to, like people will be familiar. If a system is not secure, if you are going to use this in the user name and password, it's going to get you in. If you don't want your system to be like corrupted or hacked by someone, you are going to use this prepare statements in Java. This is how we can say, yeah. Yes, see, when I put or equal to directly here, okay, when I set or equal to directly here, you can, if you have a MySQL database, you can try with that thing. It is going to let you in. Okay, it will check if it is or equal to, which is nothing. So, or, what is the function or? If you have something, one in your input, it is going to let you in, right? It is or. So, if it is or equal to, it is going to let you in. So, this is how you make your things secure, if you are going to build a platform in Java. So, multi-threaded, like thread is execution, the time you take to execution of the program, that way. So, people who have studied in computer architecture, right? Scheduling, operating system, scheduling for thread 1, 2, 3. So, if three threads are utilizing the same resources, how can we increase the performance of the system? So, that is how Java is helping you to have a multi-threaded performance. High performance. Probably faster. Yeah, it is going to give you a high performance when you really use your code with redundant data. Like you're not supposed to use your functions data again and again and again. You can use overloading. You can use overriding so that you don't have to replace your code again and again. You have this thing called objects and classes, right? So if you initiate an object at some particular time, you will be able to fetch it again. Like, I don't want you people to take notes. Is it okay? Like, listening is the best way. Some people prefer taking notes, but you can have these slides for later. And you have many tutorials to learn all these from. So I'll be giving you a kind of project to work on after this session, probably, because there is a Java servlets and jQuery, JavaScript. So you're not supposed to complete everything in 1.5 hours. So it's injustice. I will give you an example on how to do it so that you can try implementing for later. So you will realize things when you do it on your own. Rather me saying things to you, you'll be able to do things on your own. Sorry, I was like getting interrupted. So prepared statement is a predefined class. It's a predefined thing. You have it in this is a package. Like, let's come to this. It is a package which has connections, which gives you query, which gives you the way how you connect the Java to the database, everything. So this prepared statement, you can actually, it replaces the question mark. If you put question mark and you ask, the first question mark to get replaced by the username, the second question mark to be replaced by the password. So this is how prepared statement works. If you are appending the username and the password as a string, okay, then it is going to have a MySQL injection. You'll get it. Like, let's see about it later. Sometime later. Specific, I'm just giving example. It cannot be specific, right? I don't know. Like, you should say me if you know something. So, yeah, this is the thing, this is the structural diagram for why it is a platform dependent thing. So, the Java compiler compiles it into a class, which you can run it in any platform. Okay. So, we spoke about objects, object-oriented programming language, we had objects. Can anyone say me what an object is apart from this? Example of car. student, like, can you explain? Like, I don't know what a vagrant is. Okay, like you all are summer interns. Let's take summer interns as an object. So summer interns, people are from different background, right? Like different year. So some are from second year, some are from third year. Some are from different department. Everybody is from different college, university, state. But you are all summer interns, right? So you can, each and everyone can be identified by a specific thing. You are all objects. Consider you are all objects. We are identifying you by a specific characteristic. That's how we are unique. Your name, your college, your university, everything. So this is the example of an object. You have different state and different behaviors, right? Somebody feels sleepy after having coffee. Does it create a soporific effect for someone? No? Everybody will be awake. Okay. Probably you people are awake after the tea. So we are taking example of a table, car, mobile, whatever. Everything, the state of mind you people will be having. Oh, what is she teaching? I don't understand anything. Some might be teaching, oh, it's interesting. It depends on the person, right? So it's an object. And yeah, it is similar to the real world objects. That's why we chose you as examples. And you have state variables. The state variables are your department, college, university. And behavior is a method. Like, if I give an input to her, so everybody will handle a question differently, right? So she will have a method of doing it. You will have a method of doing it. You will have a method of doing it. Everything is different. So that's how we define this object. So in Java, we have something called as classes, where you put in the objects, where you start the variables, where you have the functions. So a class is an entity, like where you have all the behaviors, where you have all the states, where you have all the variables, everything. You can even instantiate anything in the classes. And methods, everybody knows, right? Instance variables. What are instance variables? Anyone? Yeah. Okay. Yeah, he's exactly right. When you run a program, when you create an object, the instance is created. How do you create an object? You have a class. This will create the instance. When you call the thing, it will create an instance. At that particular time, when you have any variable, so it will have only that value. Be it you declare anything before, only static variables and final variables will be predefined and will be there as such. So you can instantiate any number of variables. For example, her name is different from her name. So the instance at that particular time matters. You can predefine anything, but at that particular instance are called instance variables, says of the objects. Yeah, this is very important. The case sensitivity of Java. You will have a different variable. Hello with a H starting with caps and with lowercase, everything is different. So you are going to name your variables really very cautiously. Really very cautiously. And the first letter of each class should be in uppercase. It should be in uppercase. The class name should be starting with uppercase. And the method name starts with a lower case, and each and every word you will have it. So so yeah, this is it. The first alphabet. These are naming conventions, right? So you people would have known, but not everyone follows it. Do everyone follow it? Really? Okay. What is the name of the iterator variable you give for any loop? No, if you're going to do this, it's absolutely wrong. What is the iterator variable for? So you should name it an iterator variable. You cannot name it I, j, k, l, m, n, o, p can be anything. You're not supposed to have any variable name as I, j, k, l. You have to name it according to the specification. For example, if you're running a loop for finding a Fibonacci series, like whatever. So you have the variable name as Fibonacci variable or Fibonacci iterator. Okay? This is the first thing you should learn in the way of coding. You should comment it, this variable is used for this. Java docs, like you know, right? Java docs, how will Java docs be generated? Can anyone say that? How do you write a Java doc? Like, do you have the habit of commenting the code? Yeah, exactly. Like, so if you have this kind of comments, if you generate a doc, like for example, you don't have to write anything for the presentation or documents. You will just have to generate Java docs, right click, generate Java docs. It will fetch all these things and you will know it is easy to document, right? So any function, any program you write it this way. So that your name will be there, the time you created will be there, why is this function for will be there. And if you have specific return things, for example, if you use param, author, return. So param, author, return, everything you can write, like you will have the variables, what is it used for, what is the function used for. So please, like when you write code, please make sure that you write the function. And it's, you know, after you leave, we will be there to debug. So have some courtesy on us, mercy on us. So please do it this way, be it any language, be it any project you work on, always write documents this way so that you will not be feeling anything. At the end of the day, if Avinash sir is going to ask you, oh, what did you do? You can generate a Java doc and say, these are the things, these are the functions I wrote today. You don't have to sit and write a report. It depends on you. Like I write it before the function. Before the function start, this function is for this, this function is for this. If you want to further elaborate things, you can write, oh, get the connection here. Return 0, because return is null. You don't have to return anything for this. It's void. If it isn't, fetch details. So if you want to return participant ID, you are going to write it here. You don't have to particularly write it in the, above the function, but if you do it, it will be great. You will have the return there at return. So you can specify everything there so that it is not a problem. Next, program file name. Yeah, it should be same as the class name. So this is a simple program which has it. This is the object. That is where you create the object for that. So how does Java run? Like if I run this function, how will it run? Huh? Can anyone say like? So yeah, you have the static function, right? If you have static function, it's not going to ask for any object. So why can't this function run as such? Because it is not static. If you have the keyword static, we call it as keyword, right? So if you have the keyword static, it's going to run by. You don't have to instantiate an object for it to run. So it's going to run by itself. It is generating this object. And it is calling the function through this object. So that's how you get hello. Like if you had terminals, just try if you're getting it without the object. So, and then we come to the package. I mentioned it already, right? MySQL.star, like it's a package. So inside a package, you have related classes. For example, in the utility, you know util, right? Util.star. So what do you have it in util? Like anyone, like 111 each. So that I can hear, yeah.
Scanner,
okay. Then? Date, huh? Collection. Huh? I couldn't hear you. String. String? Okay, tokenizers. Tokens, you mean tokens. Okay. So these are the examples of things within a package, right? So you can make your own package called summer internship. You can have your own identity, have your own college, everything, like the courses you attend, the project you are on, everything. So we call yourself as a package. Subclasses, a class which is derived from the other class, like you have a super class, for example. Again, we can say, take the same example, you will have fetch details. So we can extend a subclass from this class, super class, and modify whatever you want to. You can override or overload the functions. That's how you can extend the classes. So you use public class. Extends. Extends is a keyword you use for. Right? Is extends is a keyword, right? So extends is a keyword we use for deriving the subclasses. And what are access modifiers? Access modifiers. Like anyone, please. I'm not getting anyone. Am I audible?
Yes.
Okay. You, like you, yeah. Say.
में तो हो जाए उसका।
Yeah, exactly. You use this access modifiers for specifying your data. That's how it's encrypted. That's how you are going to secure it. Okay? This is also one among the examples of security, you call it. So when you have a public key, like when you have a public keyword, it's going to show everything, whatever the data you have. If you are going to have a protected thing, then it will not be shown to the world, but it will be available among the class, package and the subclass with no modifier. If you are not using the keyword public, it's going to take its default and it will be available only for the class and the package. It will not be available for the subclass and the world. And it's, if it is private, yeah, it's only for the class. So you are going to declare your variables in such a way, like for example, so these are the variables we have, right? Year, department, college, university, whatever. So if you are going to fetch the variable, how do you fetch it? Object dot variable. So you have something called as bean, right? You use getter and setter methods for setting the variable and getting the variable. So in that bean class, for example, you have so if you are going to have it as a private variable, it's secure. If you are going to have a public variable, then it can be accessed by the world. You can set it from anywhere. So this is a way of securing things. You can access this variable among that class. Like if you have it within the class, then it is secure, right? If you are going to give it to the world, so if I have a chalk in my hand, it is secure. No? I don't know. Like somebody can grab it. Oh, stop teaching this nonsense. Somebody can grab it. So we cannot say, but Java is secure. We can say Java is secure this way. And this is an example of access modifier. Everything inside this class will be printed. So it is a public class, right? Public class, public int, protected, you have this thing. Everything will be visible in the same class. That's why you get the output. What is this? 1 1, please.
Instance of current class.
Huh?
Instance of current class.
Yeah, it's an instance variable within the class. So it is called as this.pub, public variable, protected variable, and this is not defined, like. So this subclass is extended from the previous class. If you try to print the value of this protected variable, private value, this will be zero because you cannot hold the variable. So make sure that your variables are private or protected or public depending on the classes. If you are going to have a derived class, use public or protected. Public or what? Default and protected. Don't use private. So yeah, these are the non-access modifier. As I mentioned already, if you are going to have a variable as constant forever, you are not going to change it, declare it as final. Declare it as final and then abstract, you are hiding it. It is called as abstracting. Static modifiers used to create a class variable, you can put it as static so that it will automatically get. And then what is this class? Okay. Synchronized. Synchronization comes with the scheduling, right? So if you are having threads, different threads, you are going to have a synchronized variable so that only one thread at a time can be evaluated. And volatile, unexpectedly by the other parts. It can be changed at any part of the program if you are naming it as volatile. The name says so. I didn't get you. So so strict FP is the strict floating point. How do you have a floating point dot? You have a decimal and 00 F. That's how you have a floating point, and if you want it as strict FP, it should be a floating point. It cannot be int. So if you are specifying your GPA, that's a bad example, right? GPA, you stick to floating point. So this is how you have to maintain the floating point things. It depends on the package you are using. See, for example, we shortlist you on the GPA, it's also considered, right? So 0.9.21 is greater than 9.20. So that is how. If it is a strict floating point, then you can actually correlate and manipulate things in a better way, right? So if I am strictly saying, oh, people no less than 9.27 is going to come for the summer internship, that's when you use the strict floating point. But we are not doing that way. Yeah, that's what the manipulation of data you need. It depends on your need. It depends on your need. So if you are going to code with a proper floating point, you need exact 2 or 3 decimals. Yeah. So it should be floating. You should specify it. It will be there. Volatile. You can change the variable anywhere. For exceptions, probably, like I can say, if you are from IIT, I can give you a GPA thing of 0.5. So if you are from IIT, I can consider even if you are 8 point something. So they're the volatile variable. It changes often, right? So it depends on the exceptions you have. Go to the types of variables: local variable, class variable, instance variable, everything. Like, we are coming back again and again. We have seen examples, right? So you can get to know what are local variables. Within a class, you are going, within a class are called class variables. Within a function, within a scope. Yeah, exactly, within a scope. It is a local variable. Class variables are static, like we can define it final, static, anything. They are called class variables. Instance variables, specific to the particular object, those are called instance variables. So yeah, this is an example of types of variables. You can just go through it. If you are not getting anything, just ask. If you declare it globally, it's a global variable. So these are called class variables. These are called class variables which are within the class. If it is a global variable, then it can be put above this as well. For example, if you have something mathematical computations, you can have pi, you can have log values as final values, right? So you can have that as global variable. So do you find any problem with this? This code? So when you run this, it goes to the main, it creates an object var. It is an object variable, it's an instance variable, var dot member var is equal to 23, static is equal to 88. So the value of the static variable will be printed, and print of var value, like it goes to the other function. So yeah, as I asked you already, like, what is public static void main? You first start writing public static void main string arguments. So this is it. What is void? It's not going to return you anything. It's the return type. Static? Yeah, you can run it as such. Like, you don't have to create an object for running the function. Public? For everyone, it's access specifier. So, what is abstraction? Abstract is hidden, hiding. Yeah, exactly. So, hiding the definitions, encapsulation. One. I can skip it, like, if everyone knows it. Yeah, exactly. Inside a class, you have the data, variables, functions, everything. So inheritance. Can you be louder? Like, so everybody can hear it.
For example, there is class A and class B. So okay. We can take the properties from class A and we can extend the properties to class B.
Yeah, exactly. So if you don't want to write the same code again and again and again, so we use inheritance. You can use whatever is pre-existing in a new class with different modifications required. And polymorphism? Yeah. So there are two types of polymorphisms available in Java. Two? Function overriding and function overloading. We all know this, right? Abstract class cannot be instantiated. You have to override all the functions if you are extending an abstract class. So, did anyone use the abstract thing in your code? Yes, where? So, I need an example. I understood the definition. I'm asking if you have used in your code. So Did everyone understand the property of abstraction, abstract classes? Can we move on? Or if anyone have doubt, you can ask again. Like, we will ask the person to give another example to you. Okay? How do we implement it? Yeah. No, it's a keyword. Like, abstraction is hiding the definition of an object. Abstract class, use the abstract as a keyword. Yeah, as he gave the example, I'll go with it. So you write whatever you want. For example, the shape has how many edges, how many vertices, how many angles can be formed, everything. You can list things here. You are going to extend this class if you are going to have a subclass. For example, public class rectangle. Extends this shape. So if you are extending a shape, you are going to override all the functions. You are going to implement all the functions which is available. For example, if I am going to get, I have a function get edges. How do you find the edges? If you know the number of vertices, or if you know the shape, if it is a cube or cuboid or rectangle or a square or a circle or a sphere, it depends. It's a shape, right? I'm not mentioning it as a two dimension or three dimension. So if you are going to implement it, you are going to use this word extends, and you are going to implement all the functions here. So that's how it is abstract. It cannot be instantiated, but can be subclass. So you are extending all the properties of the abstract class in your subclass. You are going to make it your way. You can call it two dimension, you can call it three dimensions by the subclass. So that is how it is called an abstract class. So yeah, the same example they have given here. Find area, draw shapes.
Why do we use an abstract class?
I'm just saying you can override it. Like, you can. It depends on the shape, right? So they are declaring the variables and what are the functions which can be possible. Okay.
I think you said we have to redefine it again when we use it.
Then you don't have to use it. If you feel like it's a waste of time to redefine everything, then don't do it. If you have some generic stuff, for example, you can have the number of edges, right? From this class, you don't have to redefine it every time. You have to redefine the area function. Rectangle, it's different. A square, it's different. It's going to be different for triangle. It's going to be different for the surface area of the cuboid is different. Everything is different. So that things you can redefine it, but the number of edges, the dimensions can be same. So it can be got from the abstract class. You are going to just extend it for finding the area, finding the volume, etc. Did you get it? If it is mentioned abstract, if the method is mentioned abstract, you have to implement it. If it is not, then you don't have. So yeah, we finally came to polymorphism. Polymorphism is of two types, function overloading and function overriding. So in overloading, you have more than one function with the same name. So if you have the same function name, which one will it call? So it depends on the parameters you pass. and depends on the number of parameters and type. For example, I can have it. So if I'm calling a function of rectangle with two variables, length and breadth, both can be int, it can be a float, it depends, right? So we can use the same function with different parameters. Or if you are going to find the area of a circle, we have only one radius, so we can pass the function for only one, so it is different, find area. So this is an example of function overloading. Just go through it. If you have any problem, just let me know. Is it okay? So this is overriding. So how is overloading different from overriding?
Overriding is different class.
No, I'm asking like examples. Okay. You?
For example, there are class and class. Class A, we have written function area. So class B is actually from class A, that is generated class. In this class also, we have written a function like area. We were creating an object for class B. So it's the actual function which is written in class B only. That means the function which is written in class A doesn't exist. Like the function class is overridden
by the thing. Right. Yeah. So if you are implementing, if you are extending, if you are having a super class, if you are implementing, sorry, extending the class. Implementing is used for interfaces. So extending the class, then you can override the functions as you like. So this is overriding. We had a function sum and overloading, right, in the previous example. Now we are going to override the sum with a ride. Ride is an object created for this class, going to this function and not the function of the class, super class. So it is called as function overriding. So finally, we came to threads. What is thread? We mentioned it already, right? Lightweight process. So how do you call it lightweight? Yeah, while executing, the time taken, the scheduling of different processes, everything, you call it as a thread. It's a single for execution of a program, and thread is implemented by runnable interface. So we have read this, right? So if they are going to have a quiz, it might be a question. Like, I'm not setting anything, so don't ask me if it doesn't come. It is very important. A thread implements runnable interface. You can have a thread like this. Class myThread extends thread class, or you can implement this as runnable, implements runnable. So you have three things in thread, right? Start, run, and stop. So apart from that, you have wait, you have sleep. So for implementing all this, you can extend the class, which is thread. And runnable is like, you have you don't have to start a thread by dot start. If you have it as dot run, it runs. run as a function which is used to run the thread. Like you can start at a different point, but run, it will run if you have a thread with run. Create thread implements a runnable interface or extends. Yeah. So I'm not sure about it. Like, sorry, I will get back to you on this later. So these are the thread states available. So if you are going to start it, it goes to the runnable state, and then it runs with the run function. You can make it sleep, wait, or yield. It depends on the processing you're going to schedule. The optimistic way of scheduling things, and then you can stop it by dot stop. Multi-threading is possible, right? In Java, have you used multi-threading? Where?
OS. In OS, operating system.
Like one where?
OS calls the operating system. Huh? OS course now.
Okay.
There was chapter on this one threading.
Okay.
Socket use that.
I'm not able to hear.
Socket programming.
Socket programming. You have implemented this threads. That's nice. So second years did you try? No, probably you should go and try. So yeah. Sleep is for the wait process. Like, it doesn't do anything. The thread will be hanged up as such. The memory will be cleared. Yes. It will wake up after 10 minutes. So, exception handling. Like, you get exceptions, right? While you're trying to connect it to the database, while you're trying to. Okay, if I am, so this class rectangle, if I have this int, if I am passing a float in the sum, it's going to give me an exception that I cannot add these two things because they are not integers. So it's an exception. You have two types of exceptions, like runtime exceptions and normal exceptions. You get the runtime exceptions only when you are compiling the code. And normal exceptions like input, output, you get the database exceptions, everything. So the problem which is arising during the execution of a program, like you have to handle those things in the exception handling. Where do you write the exceptions? In Java? Yeah, exactly, try catch. You are going to write the catch. What do you usually write in catch? No, one, please one. What do you write in catch? Yeah. Okay. Yeah, you write what to do when an exception is thrown. What to do? Like you want to have a log, like if you're debugging, if you're on a debugging mode, if you want to know what the exception can be, you're not supposed to write system.out.println. You're not supposed to write system.out.println. Okay, you are supposed to write the stack trace, print the stack trace, or what you should do about the exception. Never write system.out.println in your code unless it is really required. You should always use a debugger. You know to use a debugger, right? You will know to use a debugger. Like you have the breakpoints. Just go through the variables that way. You please don't write system.out.println. You are going to get scolding if you are going to write system.out.println. It is not supposed to be a good code. Okay? Have these things in mind. First one, you name the class properly. You put the variable name properly. You give a donkey as a donkey. Call it a donkey. You don't call it IJK. So, yeah. And then the third one is don't ever write system.out.println if you want to debug your code. there is the worst practice you can ever have in life. So don't write SOPs. You catch the exceptions, you actually handle the exception. You are not supposed to print, oh, this is inside this exception. I'm wrong. Don't do that. So this is the exception hierarchy. Like all exemptions are throwable. So if it is an error or exception, and then you have two types, runtime exception. The runtime exceptions mostly have null pointers. Like you forget to start to declare a variable or something like that, then you get this null pointer exceptions. For example, if I click on a login button without entering anything, and if you don't have validation, it will directly go to the database. So in the setString method, we had it here, right? If you put it, then you will get a null pointer exception. If I log in as such without any validations. Number format exception, we use it for int and float, right? So that example, class cast exception, index out of bound exception is used in arrays. Input output exception, SQL exception is like if your query is wrong, if you forget something, it's going to throw you SQL exception. Yeah, this is how you catch the exceptions. You have the code in the try block. You always write the code in the try block. If it is having an exception, it will be cached in the catch block. And finally, you are going to close the database. You have finally things to do. Whatever you want to do, you do it in the finally block. Constructors. What are constructors? One, please. Like everybody wants to speak, but when I ask one, nobody wants to. Yeah. Huh. So to initialize the members of the object, you use constructor. Do you have to write a constructor every time?
No.
It will be called automatically when you instantiate an object. So what is the return type of constructor? No return type. A constructor doesn't have return types. And the name of the constructor will be as same of the class, same as the class. So this is an example of constructor. It will be invoked automatically when you create an object. You don't have to particularly call the default constructor unless you really want to. Why it is not allowed? Yeah, we can have. You can have a constructor here as my constructor of 20. Inside that you can have 20 commands. Yeah, you can have the parameters. You can define the parameters. So you can go through all these things as references. The first one is the best. It's an Oracle thing, so you can download the PDF from the Oracle and you can go through it. That's why I said you not to take notes at the first. You are going to get everything online. It's about just giving an intro so that you don't feel weird. Some people, few people want to have some introduction so that, I have to learn this, I have to learn this. That's why this section is for. This is not for learning the entire Java in 1.5 hours. Like it's going to be one. So just go through all these materials. The quiz? No? So we will switch to JavaScript. I'm like totally tired. Okay. Where do we use JavaScript? Have you people used JavaScript? Yes, how many use JavaScript? Oh, many, good number. So, everyone can answer. Like one from this row. What do we use JavaScript?
Yes,
okay, from this side. Is he right? Yes. So exactly, you should say the thing as client side. So for developing web application, and if you want to save something for the client, if you want to have a dynamic pages, if you want to have validations, you go for JavaScript. It's lightweight. It can be embedded directly into HTML. So where do you actually write the JavaScript? In the head. The you can write it anywhere in the JSP, you can write it anywhere in the HTML, but it is a good practice if you write it in the head so that people don't have to scroll down where you have written the JavaScript function. Okay? It is used for the client side computations. So you write script to validate things. A scripting language is like, it is an interpreter based. It is not compiled. It is not compiled. So you have the faster loading of the pages. So you have to write the JavaScript inside the braces, inside the script thing. And the type should be text / JavaScript. And what can a JavaScript do? Yeah, as I said, like you can do client-side validations. You can react to an HTML element. Say for example, we have these things, right? So if you register for Facebook, when you enter the birth date, it automatically compiles like if you are more than 18 or 16. So it is reacting to the pages, right? That's why we use JavaScript. Put dynamic content on the pages and create a client-side persistent if you have cookies or the sessions. So if you log in, if you say stay signed in, so it will keep you signed in until you yourself log out, right? So it is a session variable. Yeah, this is what, like, this is the basic structure where you can write a JavaScript. What does it do? Document.getElementById? It gets the reference to the variable. Dot inner HTML? So if you run this, in your browser, what do you get? Yeah, you will get the current date, like now. So this ID demo, we are changing the inner HTML. Inside the P, we are going to write it inside the P as date. As I said, you like inside the head, you have to write a JavaScript for readable things. It is easy to debug. How do you debug a JavaScript function? Yeah, you go to the browser console. Click on a JavaScript, you can easily debug it. It is an interpreted language. You don't get the logs as Java, but you can get easily debug it. You can also use external JavaScripts for very readable code. What do we do? Like we write a form in a web application. We write, oh, the login name should be this many characters. The password should have a special character, should have uppercase, should have a lowercase, should have numbers, whatever. It's your specification. If you are going to write it separately, my JavaScript or JS, it will call itself. You are going to write inside the source for fetching the JavaScript. And have you tried this? Working without semicolons? If it's a new line, it automatically takes it. Like you don't have to put a semicolon for JavaScript. And this is how you should comment it, /// and /*. So you have different types of boxes in JavaScript: alert, confirm, prompt. You can try JavaScripts in online, right? You can try it. It's pretty easy. So these are the events you can say. Have you tried on focus? Like when you use your Google username every time, if it is on focus, it will give you a blue color print, like line border. So it's on focus, on blur, on dull, it removes the blue line. On change, it checks if the username is already existing, kind of stuff. On load, when the web page is loading, if you write certain things, it will be automatically loaded. Unload also, you will, on unload, you can reset the things. Mouse hover, mouse down. You can try all these things in JavaScript. On error, on key down, on key up, on select. So yeah, this is how you are going to have a validation thing. For the client side, you have to write a validation in the Java side as well. First for the client side to have a lighter weight, so that you have all the checks at the first without taking to the action of the Java. So you have this thing, var x, it's a very bad way of giving a variable name. The text value will be got from here. If it is null, you're going to have, oh, fill the first name, fill the last name. You can say whatever you want. You can have regular expressions for if it is an email, phone number, state, landline numbers, everything. You can have pin codes. You can have a regular expression for all these things. You can go and see regular expressions. It will be available online. So, the variable is not instantiation, but if it is an empty value, then probably a space or something, you trim it and then you get an empty variable. Yeah, so null is like you don't enter anything and press on submit, you have the null values. Example, like I give 4 spaces. Okay, if I have 4 spaces, when I trim it, it will become an empty string. You can try it. So it will be like empty string when you trim it. Trim the string. You trim the string, right? Every time you validate. So it will have an empty string. So for every form, if you are going to pass my form to the validate thing, this is how you are going to, this is for validation of the email. We have a regular expression for the email. If you don't want to do it that way, you can have your own email validation system. So you are going to check at the rate of and dot, and you are going to have how many strings you require after the dot and before the dot. So what is a cookie? What is a cookie? Yeah, it is stored in client side. What is a cookie? It's a variable or object, like whatever we want to save it as a in the session, or we have to save it for the browser. We save it as a cookie. So it's a normal, it's normally a variable. So it is stored in the visitor's computer, and then you can create and retrieve whatever you want in the session. Document object. Document object is used for getting the values using the ID, right? Document.getElementById. These are called document objects in the JavaScript. It defines the property of object or the HTML element. It can also be used to create and delete the HTML elements. Say for example, yeah, today we have 4 sessions, right? So if if it is a page which has dynamic data, for example, I'm having this day in the training, how many sessions do you have? If I enter 4, after entering 4, I can have what is the topic, how long it is going to be, and I can ask it accordingly, who is going to take it and what topic, how long it is going to be, is it an interactive session or a lecture. So we can have interactive elements when you go for the DOM object. Using these we can have interactive things. Yeah, we are getting its ID. See, for example, if you have a P, ID is equal to. When you
say document dot
document dot,
is this
yes, it is in the browser. So you get the object using the ID. You can create or delete it. Like we used it, right? Dot inner HTML is equal to date. You can replace the date by anything after 5 minutes. So these are the examples you have for the document objects. And CSS, are you people familiar with CSS? You can get it easily, you don't have to write many things in CSS. Like, what do we use for CSS? Inside the script, what do you write? Text bar CSS, that's how you write CSS. And if you want to explore more on CSS and designs, you can go to bootstrap.com. Bootstrap. You can explore many things with CSS and from Bootstrap. You can create your own design, change your layouts for like each 1 hour. You can do anything. It's an interactive thing. So if I resize the window, it will change everything automatically. So you can use an interactive thing using Bootstrap. You can also create one if you're interested. So these are the references from where we have taken the things. That's it for Java and JavaScript. So I don't have slides for JSP. I'm not going to bore you anymore, but I will give you an assignment. Like, you can try it. You can try it if you're interested. So you will feel better when you are working things out. I wanted to create a page, web page, which has just two things, login name and password. You have two buttons, submit, reset. I'll write it. So first create a page, which is very easy page, simple HTML elements. You can take it from palette. You have two inputs. Login name, username, so in the login page you have two inputs. You write the input in HTML. Everybody knows HTML, right? So yeah, and the password, submit and reset. I want the username to be unique. Yeah, you are going to fetch it from the database. You are going to have a user ID, which is the primary key. Username, it should be distinct as well, and the password, which is encrypted. You always use an encrypted password. Okay, you can use a string as well, But when you start things, you can use MD5 encryption or SSL encryption, anything you want. So you use any encryption you desire. So on submit, I'm going to validate it. I'm going to check if these two are strings. If it is not null, you have to have a proper validation, okay, everybody. So on reset, it should be resetting all the errors, all the borders, everything. Java server pages, server pages. So it works on HTTP servers. Okay. You just create a new project, okay, in NetBeans or Eclipse. Create a Java web application first, yeah. Create a Java web application, create a new JSP with this thing, and you have to write the validations in separate JS, okay, validate.js. You are going to have a separate folder called validate folder. Inside that you have the validations, whatever. You write proper codes, okay. Then how will you check it? You should, how do you access database in Java? You have the driver, right? JDBC ODBC driver. So there is a driver, JDBC ODBC bridge. You can install the driver. It will automatically set when you have a Java web application. You have to include the driver in the library so that you don't get errors. So third one is you create a database connection class. In this class, you will have you are going to mention the driver you use. Connection is equal to get driver of 3306. What is 3306? The port MySQL connects with your computer. 3306, localhost, your database and your password of the database. You are going to get the connection, you are going to throw the exception. Check first your database connection works, okay. Then you will be validating that in the Java side validation. So on press, on submit, you have to go to the JavaScript first. If it is okay, write Java validation. Write the same Java validation. If you are going to say my password should be at least 8 characters length, and if it is going to have one uppercase, at least one uppercase, one special character, you have to write the same validation in the Java side as well. Okay, you have to write the same validation in Java class as well, so you are not misinterpreting anything with the page. So yeah, then you are going to check it. You use prepared statements, okay. You are not going to append the string as such in the query. You use prepare statements and then check if you are able to log in. After logging in, you can say, if it is successful, you can say hi with the username. If it is not successful, you have to write the exceptions. You have to handle the exceptions. What are the exceptions possible? MySQL exception is possible if your query is wrong. If the input is null, you have a null pointer exception. So if you try to do this, you will have a basic idea on how to develop a web application. So it is all Java, JavaScript, everything. Just start writing things so that you will be familiar. I'm not saying things will not make you work. So just go back, try things out. You can make this easy page. It will not take more than 1 hour. If you start with installation, everything together, it will take only 1 hour for you to write this, even if you are very slow. So try it out.
Now, can't we use PHP for this database connection?
We can use, but I'm using Java, right? If you yeah, you can use PHP. You can use PHP, but the point is you are going to try these things with Java. Okay. In PHP, the database code, everything will be in the same page. If you go to the browser, like you can see it in the same PHP page. You get to see the classes you are going to write. Sorry, functions you are going to write. So here it will be encrypted. You will not be able to see the classes, class files, right? So that's why we go.
You can have,
but it can always be linked. You will not be able to see the JavaScript side validations if you are going to right click and view source. So can we try it? If you have any queries, like you have to create a database. That's why I said you are going to create a database and you are going to connect the database using this driver. You are going to first create a database. Create a database, create dummy entries, create entries, distinct entries. You have to have proper primary key and everything. You create a database with a table known as login or user, whatever you want to. Just have these two things, three things. One is the ID, one is the username, one is the password. Have these three things, that's enough. You can do this page. It's very easy. You try implementing it. If you have any queries, you can always contact me. I sit in ASL, 4987, yeah. The extension is 4987. You can call me Abhinaya. And my ID is... It's ABINAYA, not ABHINAYA. It's going to fail if you write it this way. And extension is ...4987. Please try to do this thing. If you have any issues, please get back to me. I'll be able to help you out. What? No, I don't understand. This class is in Java. You call it a Java class. Nice. So if you don't have any problem with this client side validations in your JavaScript, and if you want to say any message to them, how do you say, oh, after I log in, you get it like, hi Abhinaya, you are logged in. How do you get it? You save it in the session. Like you can have session variables. You can have a class summer interns. Okay, I'm having my year, department, college name, university, name of the person, everything. You're going to set the summer interns object in the session. You can get anything you want. For example, I am a person, right? So a person will be having an email ID to register, will be having a name, email, username, user type, gender, everything, college. So if I have to set everything, you want to have everything in the session, you can set this object. You initiate an object, person is equal to new person. You can set the person in this session. So you can have the messages, hi, welcome, you are logged in successfully. Okay, you can set it. And you can also set it through, so how do I display errors? You can have a element here, which is actually hidden in the first. PID is equal to something, display is equal to none. Display none, you are going to hide it, but you will have the message before. Or you can use inner HTML. So if the username is not matching, it's not in the, inside the database, you can have it that way. You can give your own messages. You can actually hard code it here, or you can take it from application properties. You can have number of messages which are required. You have it in your property file. You can fetch it. You can fetch the error messages. You will know like when you actually try things. Okay, if you have any problem, get back. I think it's okay, right? Any other queries? Will you be able to try it? Yeah, if you have any queries, always get back. Thank you. Any other query? No, everybody knows Java. Okay. Java server page. It's a page which has, you can have HTML elements in it. You can also have a, you can also write Java in it. How do you write Java inside a JSP? In this you can write Java. And if you write it as such, it is a HTML, normal HTML thing. Input, P, H tags, it's a normal input. So this you call it as a JSP, a page, a browser like which is visible to you, it's a Java servlet page. Whereas servlets are Java classes, where you validate things, where you validate, you have functions, it is called a servlet. You have HTTP response, HTTP request. So for processing the request, you have the servlets. So say for example, if you're connecting to a database, you can use servlets. But servlets are very basic. You can try it with servlets. Then you can go for struts, Hibernate, Spring in the later part. Like just get it done with the servlets first. Create a simple Java class. I don't want you to say it is a servlet or a strut file, whatever. You just map it and you write things in a class, Java class. Anything else? Nothing? Probably yes. Probably no. I don't know. Like, yeah, we have the quiz questions. I'm not sure if you will be taking it. You might be taking it. Like, who are all working in Java projects? So, yeah, like, it depends on the quiz as well. You will be sorted out according to what you are strong in. Like, there are more Java projects. CDEEP will have Django. FOSI will have Django. If you are going to MOOCs, it is also Python. So there are two more projects which you are going to implement it using Java web applications. So the probability is, I don't know, it's your fate. So if you will be taking the quiz, yeah, do it right. It will not be very hard. Yeah, but it will be okay.